Good afternoon. My name is Brett Enns, and I was the team lead on RPIW number 26. This is the tack time that we worked into 20 minutes to share our findings with you. This is our group that has been assigned to us. Thank you. This is this beautiful, lovely group that has been assigned. And I want to tell you how much we appreciate each one of you that has been with us this past week. I want to acknowledge Carol Gregory, who is our sponsor, and Sean Fanef, who has been our process owner. Both have been instrumental in this work. My sub-team lead, Taylor Bassingway, about whom I could not have even been here without. And our Kaizen support, Mr. Ian Johnson, thank you. Also, too, we had the privilege of working with Sensei Narada and Michiko, his interpreters, thank you. And we had a number of our participants, we had the fortunate, or the great fortune to have two lean leaders training with us, and Ricky Skiffington, who is a nurse that is working with us as a lean leader trainer, or in training, and also our friend from Kiwatinyathe, Dale West, the Director of Communications, so it really helped to have a Director of Communications. We had some content experts working with us who worked specifically with the orthopedic clinic, and that was Val Eisbester, who couldn't be with us today, and our thoughts are with her and her family today, as well as Karen Diswich, who works as an LPN in that particular department. Also, Aaron Zalowski. Aaron is a brand new unit clerk to ambulatory care. And she has been there for 3 weeks, and they love her to bits, and they have not let her go. So we had to really talk really kind of nice to get her with us. So that was awesome. From patient directory services, we had Linda Birdwood come in and help us with all of some intricacies that we had with patient flow. And finally, certainly not the least, is our patient advocate and representative, Audrey Swan, and we really appreciate having you with us, Audrey. Our theme for this RPIW was to decrease the lead time and improve patient flow for clients accessing the CAS clinic, Victoria Hospital, from arrival of ambulatory care to discharge. Just from our work initially at the RPIW, here are some specific kind of baseline measures that we took. Cast room, if you've ever been there, and hopefully you've never been there, but if you have, you'll know it's a pretty confined space and there's not a lot of room. And so we were able to look at that space, identify that the cast room shelving and flooring could be reconfigured and used a little bit better, so we were able to look at that. The big thing that hit us is that people who have broken body parts are walking almost 1,100 feet to get services. And that, to us, was unacceptable. The other piece of it, and you'll hear more about this later, is the parts traveled. And when an LPN or a nurse has to fix or do a dressing training change on somebody's injury, they needed to walk 202 feet to get that dressing bundle and then come back in terms of to do the process. So you're going to hear a bit about that success. And I think that that's pretty much all I want to share with you, but thank you for being here today.
One of the first things that we do during an RPIW week is something called the waste walk. For those of you that aren't familiar with that, essentially the team starts by going out into the area, onto the gamba, and looking for places and processes where they identify waste. What our team identified in our current state, which is now our past state, value stream map, essentially a picture of what the processes look like for a patient from the time they come to when they see a physician. What our team identified as wastes that I'll highlight for you here, around poor signage for patients and families. Again, as Brett mentioned, the distance traveled for patients and their families. There was poor printer access for providers that was causing poor workflow. There was inappropriate storage, which was really valuable real estate that was repurposed, as you'll hear about later. those of you that aren't familiar with a word called tack time, what I tell you here is it's essentially something that helps us calculate, understand better our supply and demand. Our tack time was 8.4. Clearly that doesn't mean that's the time we're spending with a patient. What that does mean, we need to pull someone out every 8 minutes, meaning to keep our flow going well for all the patients that we need to see, that's what we have to be hitting. To tell you a little bit more about this area, the ambulatory care area has all of these on the left happening. Where we focused was in the orthopedic clinic. The folks that are working there during the times that we were looking to do improvements were three licensed practical nurses, or three registered nurses, or one orthopedic technician, and one unit clerk. They run a four-day week, so Monday to Thursday they go, what is it, it's 9 to 12:30, and then 12:30 to 4. When we look at the number of patients that we're seeing, the blue line graph out there is the orthopedic patients. The others are red, colposcopy, and green is ophthalmology. That blue line tells us that on average we're seeing in the orthopedic clinic about 34 folks a day. Of course, as Deb mentioned earlier, communication, very important. This team is fantastic with talking to people on the Gamba, doing a lot of that, what we call Nema Washi, which is essentially trying to get people to buy in before and be aware of what's happening before the RPIW weekend during it. And our team lead was fantastic in doing that, attending huddles, going to staff meetings, trying to get some of that information out there in addition to the forms that we put up. What we then did was broke into sub-teams. So we have sub-teams of patient, and then another group that worked on quality, and another group that worked on the 5S. So first that will be Dale that's up with the patient sub-team.
Thanks, Taylor. I am Dale. My partner in this process was Audrey as well. We started, obviously, the starting point, we looked at the times. As Brett noted, we had a lead time of 50 minutes to start with. We have another, our standard work combination sheet just simply shows that a little bit more visually. We also examined cycle times for the actual providers. And I think more importantly, what we really focused on was the spaghetti diagram. Almost 1,100 feet, starting at admitting, working their way up and around to a far waiting room. Then they had to go through ambulatory care and through day surgery before they even got to cast room. Many went to DI, went through to an x-ray, and they noted when they got up in this hallway that there was admitting. At any rate, moving along. What was our ID? What did we want to do? We'd seen that we had all these component areas that were separate. People were starting here, going to consulting. They were then having to go through ambulatory care, day surgery before they got to the cast room. So we wanted to consolidate our area. We wanted to make things adjacent to each other. So we looked at trying to get our cast room, our consult offices, and our transition zone together. What did we end up with? A new transition zone close to right beside the cast clinic. We changed signage both of to denote areas as well as to show people flow, to be able to direct people. We found that from admitting, if you look down the hall to where people used to go, there was nothing. There was no line of sight. So we created signs. We also created a personal sign. We created a patient information sheet, which people received when they arrived at admitting with a map to the new area. Also doing a little bit of promotion for us. And I think, but also it helped note these patients arriving were not necessarily for day surgery, and also because it didn't quite go as smoothly as we would have liked, they could then blame us as opposed to the staff for any issues. So for that, we created standard work. Thanks for Linda for doing that. Standard work on the skill training checklist so the folks at admitting would know what was going on and would go through it. So what did we end up with? We decreased our lead time down to 45 minutes. Again, standard work shows that process again, how that worked out. And we looked at those cycle times. We were able to decrease those. Drum roll, please. We decreased that walk distance to 914 feet. 16%. But it sure feels like a lot more than that. That psychological barrier of no longer seeing the admission desk, I think, is going to help.
I'm Linda, and I'm with Team Quality. Team Quality was tasked with reducing the deficit rate on the ortho clinic x-ray requisitions to zero. A previous RPIW established a process to track these deficits. During prep week, a deficit rate of 7.3% for August of 2014 was identified. With assistance from the staff at X-ray, we were able to determine that the majority of errors occurred in the exam request area. It was also determined that no current standard work was being followed to ensure requisitions are checked and errors are eliminated. I'll hand over to Erin.
Hi, I'm
Erin.
I'm the unit clerk for Athens Berkshire. And I made the standard work for myself and for the nurses as well too. So the first one I made, it included what I did to get the information onto the request for the patients. The second was for what the nurses do with the request once the patient is in the task clinic. And the third is what the nurses complete, let's say when we have an add-on aspect. I also made a skill training list to make sure we all get training on that properly. And I also made a task clinic forms binder so that the task clinic has the necessary forms they need at right at the task clinic instead of going back and forth through the desk.
Hi, my name is Karen. I'm an LPN. And I'm a member of the 5S, T5S. I'm speaking on pre-climax. So in Boris's group, or the workbook text, it's not just Boris. There was a storage room, aka junk room, where other things that were in his way or not, you know, just had no use for it were kind of shoved in that room. So Ian did the evaluation of the items that were needed for the cast room or not needed, and they were reallocated. It scored a 1.2. The ones that were red tagged were repurposed somewhere else. And one that I took out of there was an old saw. Boris has got a new one. Or the orthotex got a new one. And we took the old one to PR and they were ecstatic. It was way quieter and much easier to look after. So now we end up with a well-cleaned, painted room that we can use for a cast pick.
Okay, so you can see that we've got you can see that we have an idea summary sheet up. So our just our idea was there's that storage area. Really, it's not storing anything that we're using all the time. It's just a spot where we left stuff. And couldn't we use that as a room that was more close to the ortho room that we could use as a cast in? So when we first got in, there was a little bit more supplies that we sorted through. And there was one cupboard that had some very old expired items that came to a cost of $60.33. And the winner for the oldest expired item went to a box of offsites that expired in July of 2005. This is what the storage room looks like now. So this is clinic room two. So there's the desk with the computer for the physician, the surgeon, and then you can see that there's less shelves that are in there. A little bit of supplies still for the ortho tech that's in there. That's a little bit extra for him. But you can see in the top right corner on the next sheet that there's an area now where we've got the supplies for the nurse and the surgeon that's right there for them, and it's all labeled and ready to go. And we created a work standard that at the end of every cast clinic, the nurse will then restock that area, and we've listed what needs to be there. As well, you'll see in a later picture, but we posted a picture as well of what the standard is, so that at a glance can tell what's missing. The other thing we had to do, because there wasn't really an area in that the clinic rooms that was safe and secure where we could store injection vials, we had to create some injection kits. So there's two we created. This is what
picture of what they look like. And along with that, we did some more work standards. There was two. One kit is for Dr. Bridgel and Dr. Martins and what they use for their injections. And the second kit is for Dr. Moodley and Dr. Silvera and what they use. It's a little bit different. So, the other thing that we noticed, where we moved all the clinic rooms over, we now, our supplies were all located over by the ambulatory area, but all our clinic rooms are now over in the other area. So the nurse was going to have to do walk 202 feet per dressing change to get a dressing change kit if they needed to do one, which they may do more than once in a clinic. So what we did was we have a couple shelves in Morris and on Morris, the orthotech area, where there's a couple shelves with just some key stocks that we can resupply. And now you can see on the next one that the nurse now just has to go 62 feet per dressing change, so a reduction of 69% where she's now freed up to do other work. The other thing that we had noticed was inside the cast room, so the orthotech room, there's two beds in there. We moved, there's a desk with a computer that we moved in the middle of the two beds. However, there was only one curtain going between the two beds. So if they were wanting to show the client that came in their x-rays, you'd have to open the curtain and they'd be exposed to the other client in the other bed, and that client could then see their x-rays on the screen and know what was going on. So on the next picture, you can see we installed another curtain. So now each bed has a curtain so that you can have it closed when they're in with the other one, and we can have it open for them. The other room, this is clinic room one now, so one of the other new clinic rooms where it used to be where we had one of the lasers for the ophthalmologist that we moved out and we have repurposed it. We have a temporary supply cart in there for this room, and it's all labeled as well. That's the picture that we've got up top for both supply rooms of what's supposed to be there, and we do have a standard bed table that'll stay there, that's stable on order. We did some work standards for restocking at the end of the rooms, and along with that, we also have some multi-skills training that we'll do with all the nurses that work that. So post 5S, when we did the evaluation, we were a 1.2, and now we're at a score of 3. And then just moving on to wrap up a little bit. So with our newspaper, there are some outstanding items. There are some are kind of smaller items. One of the things that's on here that I'll point out is the printer. There was no printer in the orthotech room. So they did order one, and I'm happy to say that as of this morning, they were setting that up, and it should be up and running, and that'll be 100% completed when we hand it off. When you move on to our second page, there's a couple smaller items, but one of the big things was one of the rooms that we're going to be using for the class cast room, we weren't able to rearrange it this week because there are lasers that are in there that the ophthalmologists use, and we have to get the manufacturers to move them. So, they are coming in November, and we will then have everything over in one area and have a little bit more room. When you look at our target progress report, big thing, the space square footage in the cast room, that area that just was not being used that we've now repurposed. So there's 84% that was put out there that we're now actually using for patient care. With the walking distance for the patient, again, we decreased it by 16%, although to them it feels like a lot more than that. And also the part traveled with sterile dressing trays. We really eliminated some walking that the nurse had to do. So there was a 69% decrease there. As well, a really big thing was our defects. As the week went on and we put the standard work into place on our last day, we were at a zero defect rate, so 100%. Our waste bill, we managed to eliminate 19 out of the 43 items, so a reduction of 44%. And our post-Kaizen value stood in that. So we eliminated some of the starbursts, and the lead time was decreased by 8%, and the cycle time by 10.
Hi, I'm Audrey. I work from Dale on the patient perspective. So, workshop summary. All client oral services are not adjacent to one another, and the cast room and orthotech are right there. So treatments are quicker. We've made a direct path from admitting to the ortho cast clinic. There's simpler navigating, less travel, and a new transition area. The cast room has better flow and provides more privacy. X-ray requisition errors have been eliminated. patients don't have to make that extra trip to diagnostic imaging. There's less walking and less confusion. Keeping the patient first makes experience better for them all. Thank you. The patients and their families, to our sensei and Michiko, to our volunteers, to the orthopedic surgeons, the ophthalmologists, and especially Dr. Moodley and Dr. Uglas, who are most impacted by this, it seems. The staff of ambulatory care, of day surgery and maintenance, information technology, print shop, registration, and environmental services. Thank you.